As the assistant conservator, I write treatment proposals for each artifact before working on it. These proposals have multiple treatment steps, one for each technique or process that I plan to use. In this video, you'll see me working on several steps simultaneously over different parts of a TAPA. This is both for the sake of efficiency and to let each part of the TAPA dry before I come back to it. You'll see me reshaping folded and creased sections of the TAPA using damp blotter paper and soft weights over a barrier layer. Once the folds are evened out, it's easier to tell which sections need repair. Most of these repairs will happen on the back side of the artifact so that they will be minimally visible from the front. The exception is when I find a tear that looks as though it will get worse if I turn over the TAPA before addressing it. Before I get to that step, you'll also see me consolidating sections of the black painted design using a paintbrush and methyl cellulose. Consolidation binds crumbling paint back together. I'm also cleaning off white crystal growth using water on a cotton swab. The black paint tends to be the least stable component of the TAPAs in our collection because, in addition to cracking and flaking, it contributes to the acidification of the bark itself. This acidification is what causes a lot of the tears and holes that we see in these TAPAs. When I turn the TAPA over to work on the back, you can see where the paint has bled through the bark. These darker areas are very brittle and prone to tearing. We often prefer using other plant-based materials when repairing plant-based artifacts. Here, I mend tears and make patches using wheat starch paste and Japanese tissue, which, like many TAPA, is also made from mulberry trees. We always want our repair materials to be compatible with the original artifact, safely reversible, and slightly weaker than the artifact. This is so that just in case the TAPA is put under any kind of accidental stress, it's my modern repair that will fail rather than the original material forming a new tear. Most of my repair patches on this TAPA were color matched to the exact areas that they cover. The exceptions were the two large patches I added to one side of the TAPA that are visible from the front, which I matched to the natural color of the bark rather than to the section of yellow and black decoration that was missing. I chose to avoid trying to recreate the missing section of original art in a way that would obscure the history of the piece, partially because these fills had to be so large. Here, the goal was to prevent the tears from getting worse without stepping over a line that would have imposed too much of an artistic intervention on the TAPA. That was a line that I didn't feel justified in crossing at this time. Once I make all my repairs and let them dry, I turn the TAPA back over to make sure that everything looks all right from the front. I trim the edges of a few tissue fills, and then that's it for this treatment. The TAPA is now stable enough to be rolled up for storage or put on short-term display.